My name is Doria. I'm hosting this thing. This thing is called Sexy as Folk. We're going to be telling folk tales for an adult crowd. That's also you. All right, so just for shits and giggles, I decided that the theme for this year's adult, for this month's adult folktale telling is just going to be sexy folktales. Believe it or not, there are a lot of sexy folktales, legends, and myths out there. So once upon a time, not too long ago, but long enough ago, there was a sculptor, an artist. He made statues, lifelike, beautiful, realistic statues. Sometimes, you know, religious statues, Moses and Noah and the Ark, you know, beautiful lifelike statues. And he had a nice house and a studio attached to the house filled with these beautiful lifelike statues. Now, he was married very happily to a beautiful and intelligent woman. And the two of them had a wonderful life together, except they were nice church-going folks. They went to the church every week. And the parson, the sexton, and the church organist, this is kind of like the last story, they were a bunch of pussy chasers. And the moment they saw the sculptor's wife, they started, each one of them, bothering her and harassing her and chasing her around and giving her trouble. They were always kind of saying, you know, they always had little shit things that they had to say. They were always like, hey, look, a nice today. Real creepy, just asshole types. Wouldn't leave her alone. Made her real uncomfortable. And, you know, her husband was aware, and he was like, oh, geez, I don't know what to do about these guys because they were important in the community, you know, pillars of the community, those kind of assholes. And so they were, you know, the husband and wife, you know, talked about this, like, what are we going to do about these three jerks? How are we going to get them, you know, to leave you alone? And the two of them came up with a fantastic plan, and this is how it went down. So one Friday, the sculptor's wife had three different conversations, one with the parson, one with the sexton, and one with the church organist. And she made a date with each one of them. She said, okay, tomorrow, Saturday, my husband is going to be gone all afternoon, so I want you to come over and hang out with me at our house alone. Oh, all three of them were like, yeah, baby, I'll be there. Oh, what time? So when she talked to the parson, she told him, be there at 3. Okay, I'll be there at 3. But see, then she talked to the sexton, and she said, be there at 3:30. Oh, yeah, I'll be there at 3:30, baby. And she talked to the church organist and told him to be there at 4. So she has them lined up 3:30 and 4. And she has this all planned out with her husband. So, okay, great. So there she is at home. Her husband's out. 3 o'clock, bing, bong, the doorbell rings. And there's the parson. Hey, baby, how's it going? She says, why don't you come on in? They hang out, they chit-chat. He kind of keeps edging closer and closer on the couch. And she says, well, why don't you get comfortable? You look kind of uncomfortable with all those clothes. He was wearing, like, his best suit that he usually saved for Sunday, but he was, like, he got himself all dudded up with his best clothes. And so he takes off his tie and his jacket and everything. And pretty soon, there he is. He's sitting buck naked on the couch. How you like me now, baby? And she's like, yeah, really, really great. Well, it's 3:30. Bing, bong. Oh, my gosh. It must be my husband. Quick, run, hide in the studio. And the parson's like, wait, he's buck naked. But her husband's coming home. So he runs for it. And he runs, hides in the studio, and freezes. So there's the parson, buck naked, in the studio. Okay, and she takes the clothes, hides them under the couch, and in comes the sexton, second asshole. She, you know, she repeats the whole thing, hey, baby, yeah, come on in, here, sit down. And he's trying to paw and get some. And she manages to get him to take all of his clothes off, the idiot. And then, of course, you know, the doorbell rings, ding dong, oh my gosh, it's my husband, quick, run and hide. And so he goes, runs and hides. So now there's two just jackass, naked fools in the studio. And she hides another set of clothes. And then the church organist, so the same routine. So finally, at 4:30, I think it is, her actual husband, as planned, knocks on the door. Hey, honey, I'm bringing some guests. Oh, hi. So the church organist, naked, joins the other three. So now we got three naked dudes hanging out in the studio. In comes the husband. Hey, honey, I brought some clients home. They want to take a look at my work. Oh, great, lovely. Let's go look in the studio. So they go into the studio. They look around. There are all these beautiful statues, very lifelike. And now the parson was over here, naked. The sexton's over here, naked. And the organist, I don't know why, but he went over in the corner and he was doing something like this. I don't know why. I don't know if he thought he would be less obtrusive if he was on his hands and knees with his ass in the air. I think maybe he was trying to hide his face. I don't know. But there he was. And so they're the clients, the sculptor's wife, and they're looking around. Oh, yes. Oh, very lifelike detail. Oh, it's fascinating. Oh, my goodness. Admiring all the statues. Oh, look at this. This one's not so handsome as the others, but, you know, the sweat is so lifelike. Oh, it's wonderful. Oh, look at, oh, what's this? You know. And the sculptor looks down and goes, oh, this one? That is my candlestick holder. Here, let me show you. And he takes a candle, lights the candle, I shit you not, and stuffs it in the church organist's ass. And the church organist, remember, is like, you know, he has to be frozen, right? He's a statue. He doesn't move. Got it? Now we have two naked guys and a third naked guy with a lit candle burning in his ass. Okay, so they're looking around, and one of the other clients is looking closely at the parson and the sexton and thinking, you know, these two, they're kind of different from the others. So could you tell us what you had in mind when you carved them? Oh, yes. Well, you know, I've been working on a piece called Adam and Eve. Adam and Eve looks more like Adam and Steve. I mean, look at that. And the sculptor says, oh, well, you know, I hadn't gotten to that part. I'm in the middle of converting this statue. But if you hang around, I got my chisel and my hammer here, and I can adjust that part right now. And he goes up to the sexton, and he's getting ready to chop. Now, just at that moment, remember the church organist? The candle has been burning. It's a wax candle. It's been burning. And the wax has been dripping, and I think it must have been just about that moment that some of the melted wax started to drip down from his asshole, and it must have gone on his junk, because at that point, he emitted a very high-pitched scream. I'm not going to try and imitate that for you. I'm just going to tell you what I tell the children, which is, use your imagination. And imagine the high-pitched scream that comes when a man's genitals become coated in hot wax. And so he jumps up, and the candle was really firmly lodged, so the candle is still lit and going in his ass. And he goes running out of there. Oh my gosh, it's a miracle. Oh wow, the statue came to life. And look, oh, Adam and Steve are running right after him. Yeah, well, the church organist ran all the way back to the church. And lucky for the parson and the sexton, the candle in his ass lit the way home for them. So that's good. So they all made it home, right? Okay. So, you know, problem solved. So the next day is Sunday. Everybody goes to church. And everyone noticed the parson, the sexton, the church organists were all wearing really crappy clothes. And everyone's like, what happened to your good clothes? You always dress so nicely for church. And the parson's like, I had a bad night. And the sexton said, oh, I don't want to talk about it. And the church organist, all he could say was, dilee, dilee, dilee. And that's the end of that story. Everybody, give it up for Mike Cohen. He's going to tell you a story.
Dear Penthouse, I never thought I would be writing a letter to the Penthouse Forum, since I'm a medieval knight who once dedicated himself to purity and preserving chastity, but the way things have gone for me, it makes sense. I started out as a medieval knight, and even though we're separated by 1,000 years or so, time and space don't mean that much to me. I was the kind of young man that, even though I was a knight, if someone said, do not go to that hill of the fairies, don't go there during the day, don't go there at night, don't go there in the evening, don't go there at night, especially do not go there on the full moon, I went. And I approached the hill of the fairies, and there were the gleaming lights of the fairies dancing and carrying on and having one heck of a party. And I drew closer on my horse, and I saw the queen, and she was fair and beautiful. And I never suspected that so good-looking a woman could be that fast or agile or malicious. She leapt forward and wrestled me off my horse. And then I was her property, and I had to do the bidding of the fairies for 7 long years. Now I have to explain that in the home of the fairies, time goes at a different rate in the normal world. And 7 years in the hill of the fairies is who knows how many years in the real world. 7 times 7, 7 times 100, I don't know. But I was their slave for 7 long years. And besides being their champion and defending them against other fairy groups, I had a particular task. The queen had a rose garden called Carter's Haw. And now rose gardens are rare in this island, especially year round. Yet the queen had a beautiful rose garden that bloomed year round and could only be seen by virgins. And so when virgins heard about this magical garden with roses, they of course wanted to go and pick a rose. And whenever a maiden appeared in front of the garden and began to pick a rose, it was my job to magically appear, and I had 2 tasks, either to get her kirtle or her maidenhead. Now back then, a kirtle was pretty much your only garment. So if I got their kirtle, they would have to go home naked. So many of them rather gave up their maidenhead to me and preserved the shame beneath their kirtle. After almost 7 years, a young woman appeared and was determined to pick a rose. And I confronted her and said, your kirtle or your maidenhead? And she said, well, seeing as how you're here and I'm here, I guess it'll be my maidenhead. And now this is the part where it gets interesting, Penthouse, because I had been with the queen for a long time and she was very experienced, a little too experienced, if you know what I mean, and kind of nasty and freaky in some unpleasant ways. And then I had been with a lot of, well, maidens who weren't very experienced being maidens, and not always that exciting. But this young lady was enthusiastic, and she was yelling things in Latin to encourage me. Sidious, Sidious, non, non erit fini, tu spera, tu magna spera, and so on. And I guess she had a very good Latin tutor, and having her yell dirty things in my ears certainly was helped, and it was very nice. And then she reappeared. Now I have to tell you, I don't usually get too many repeat customers, since once you're not a maiden anymore, you're not a maiden anymore. But there she was again. And she came back a few more times, and then she came back another time, and rather than saying, oh, hey, let's carry on in Latin, she said, I've got to talk to you. My friend didn't come to visit me this month. And I said, oh, that's interesting. Well, you're going to have to tell someone about this. You should start with your father and see how he takes it. She was back the next day. Her father, who was the local kinglet or prince or whatever, did not take it very well. And she said, he wants to marry me off to my biggest and stupidest knight, who I do not want to be married to. And my father says, if I don't marry him, I will have to produce the actual father. And I said, well, I don't really do a lot of public appearances. I kind of show up here at the Ha to defend the roses. Sometimes I go to other, I appear in front of the Hill of the Fairy Folk to defend it against other fairies since I'm their champion. And well, on All Hallows Eve, which is tomorrow, we kind of ride in a big procession because the Queen of the Fairies has to pay a tithe to Hades, who runs hell. And let me finish. The queen has to pay a tithe, and it's usually a sacrificial victim who's on a white horse, and we all go and we have a big party, and we all come back except for the person on the white horse, who this year is me. So I said, well, listen, Janet, because that was her name, Janet, I said to the ex-maiden I'd been carrying on with, if you want a father for your baby and a potential husband, you're going to have to follow my instructions. And I told her what she had to do. And the very next night, there we were, a big procession of us on horses. I was in the middle on a white horse, and Janet had stationed herself at this crossroads, and right at midnight, she jumped up and wrestled me off my horse. Now, you may have heard this story before. There's all these versions. And I will tell you that they don't even tell you the half of it, because the queen changed me into anything she could think of that would put a young girl off. Janet was holding on to me, and I got turned into a salamander. I don't mean one of these little pink things. I mean a dragon, breathing flame and on fire, a red-hot bar of iron, a basket full of oranges, a literal bushel full of pearls that scattered on the ground and went in all different directions. And somehow she managed to hold on to me. And at last, there I was, a naked knight in her arms, and she covered me with her kirtle. Talk about a switcheroo. And there I was, naked in her arms and covered in her kirtle, and we rode back to her father's hall on her pony, and I showed up to ask for her hand in marriage and a place in his hall wearing her kirtle. I had to fight for my place. Now, fortunately, I'd spent who knows how many years fighting against the fairies who knew every dirty trick and being their champion. So I beat all the other knights, and now I'm the champion. And it's been very interesting. Janet has been a good wife. We've had a good relationship. But there are times when I have to tell you, Penthouse, I think about the queen and all those tricks she knew and her strange appetites. It's hard to forget. And as much as I love my wife, I have to admit I still sometimes think about her, the queen, that is. And that, Penthouse, is my story.
Thank you, Mike. All right, just because I am, as my daughter likes to say, hashtag that mom, I'm gonna tell you a dirty joke. Okay, so what's the difference between erotic sex and kinky sex? Okay, right answer, I don't know. The answer is, during erotic sex, you use a feather, and during kinky sex, you use the whole chicken. Use your imagination, right? So this is a modern day, woo! Trying to get fresh on me there, Mike. This is a modern day Ojibwe story. Ojibwe are Native Americans who live in the upper Midwest around Minnesota. Once upon a time, there was a 12-year-old boy, an Ojibwe boy, and he went skinny dipping one day with his buddies, and as is their wont, the boys kind of were like, sort of checking each other out, just a little bit, not too much, but just kind of like, And this one boy felt that he just wasn't measuring up to his buddies. He was like, damn, I got a small pecker. Shit. He's just thinking this. And so it bothered him. So he decided, You know, I mean, so this is a mid-20th century story, but they still had medicine men in their community, so he decided, I'm going to go to the medicine man, talk to the medicine man, see if he's got anything I can do about my small pecker. 12-year-old boy goes to the medicine man. He's very polite. He brings some tobacco, and the medicine man says, oh, sit down, my son. Yeah, what's the problem? And the kid says, well, I got a small pecker. Is there anything I can do about it? And the medicine man says, oh, yes, my son. Sure. I'll tell you what you do. You go out and you get yourself some bear grease, real good bear grease. You rub it on your pecker every night at bed for a year. At the end of a year, your pecker will be large. Oh, great, thanks, sir. Okay, so the kid goes home and he's like, oh, yeah, I've got a plan. He's full of hope. Ooh, a year from now, I'm gonna have a big-ass pecker. Ooh, this is gonna be great. And he goes home. Now, his mom and a bunch of her friends are all hanging out in the kitchen, and they're making Indian fry bread. And she's got this big can of Crisco on the stove. And the kid's looking at it and going, oh. And he's like, where the hell am I gonna get bear grease anyways? They don't sell it at the shopping store. While his mom's not looking, he just kind of takes a dollop of that Crisco, sneaks upstairs to his room, and oh, that worked real well. Okay, great. So every night, religiously, for a year, this kid rubbed his pecker with Crisco, and his mom is like, I don't get it. I keep running out of Crisco. I don't want to make fried bread that often. So at the end of the year, the kid looks at his pecker, and he's like, God damn it, my pecker is no bigger than it was a year ago. What the hell? And he goes back to the medicine man. He's trying to be respectful, but he's like, Mr. Medicine Man, sir, you know, I did like you told me and everything for a goddamn year, and my pecker doesn't look any bigger. You know, if anything, it looks smaller to me now. What the hell? And the medicine man was like, well, son, did you use the bear grease like I told you? And the kid's like, no, man, I used Crisco. I couldn't find any of that bear grease shit. I just used Crisco. Oh, no, son, don't you know Crisco? It's shortening. That's me. I always try and keep it classy.
So in 1987, the Pope went to Chile because the dictatorship was about to fall, and he wanted to make sure that the church was safe even as the state collapsed around it. And the Pope gives this huge convocation in the middle of the central soccer stadium in Santiago, and 100,000 people for the first time get out to emote and be together under the guns of the secret police. And the Pope goes, people of Chile, do you reject the idol of wealth? And they all go, see, we reject the idol of wealth. And he says, do you reject the idol of power? And 100,000 people are going, see, we reject the idol of power. And the Pope warms to his task. He says, people of Chile, do you reject the idol of sex? And they said you could hear a pin drop in the stadium as the Pope looked up, furious, and that was the last time the Pope ever visited Chile. Thank you.
This is a myth from the Hindu tradition. Okay, so once upon a time, and I'm going to have to think hard to keep track of all these gods. There's a lot of gods in this story, which is why it's a myth. So Brahma, the god of creation, created a whole bunch of beautiful women. I don't know why. Just beautiful women. He just decided to kind of stretch his powers and just see what he could do. And he created five beautiful, beautiful women. And the most beautiful of them was called Ahalya. And she was absolutely just drop-dead gorgeous. And all of the rishis, the saints, and the gods, and the humans, and everybody was just like, oh my God, she's so hot. And Brahma thought, okay, so now what am I going to do with these five hotties? And he decided he'd stow them away for a little bit and then bestow them in marriage. Whatever. And all of the gods and the humans, everybody was just salivating over these women, and in particular, Ahalya. So he sent off Ahalya to be with Maharishi Gautama. And Maharishi Gautama, I guess, he was like a sage or a saint. So he's not a god. He's kind of a guy, but he's got, like, great powers of meditation and concentration, and he can shut things down if he needs to. He's very controlled. And he's very careful. You know, he takes care of Ahalya, and he raises her through the difficult teenage years, and there's no hanky-panky, and everything's cool. But meanwhile, in the outside area, everybody's kind of salivating, waiting for this young woman to be of age, to be given in marriage. And, you know, it's patriarchy. Who are we kidding? And in particular, there's Indra. And Indra is, so Brahma was the creator, and then Indra is like the leader of the gods. He's kind of your, as I see it, he's kind of your classic sky god, Jupiter, Zeus, Thor. You know, he does the weather, he bosses people around, and he's a pussy hound, skirt chaser, goes after women, you know. So of course he's got his eye on this girl. Ooh, she's fine, okay. So finally the day comes and Brahma decides that Ahalya is ready to be bestowed in marriage on some guy. And he, you know, he sets a contest, right? It's such bullshit. But he sets a contest. He says, okay, whoever can circumnavigate the earth and get back to me first will win her hand in marriage, because that shit makes sense, right? Like, Fine. So everybody goes out like, ooh, everyone decides they're gonna run around the world, and they're just running for that shit, like, oh, pussy, oh, and they're running. Meanwhile, the Maharishi Gautama, the great sage, he stayed home because he was watching a cow, a divine cow, give birth. And apparently he found that just entrancing. And really, really fascinating. And he was meditating on this cow, and she's giving birth. And he's so moved. He's forgotten all about the gorgeous Ahalya. He's so moved watching this cow birth a calf. And he walks all around the cow and the calf, meditating. I don't know. I don't think I could meditate with that going on. But he goes all the way around. And Brahma, the creator, sees this, and he goes, ah. He walked around the cow giving birth, and that is the equivalent of walking all the way around the world, because that shit surely makes sense, right? And so Brahma, the creator, decides that Ahalya is going to marry the Maharishi Gautama because he can walk around a cow, and everybody else comes running back from running around the earth, and they're like, what the fuck is this shit? But it's too late, and she's married, and it's done. Except there's still Indra, remember the pussy hound? So he's out there and he's watching and he's like, I don't care if she's married, I'm gonna get me that pussy. And so he's stalking her and he's watching her day after day, and he's watching her husband, the Maharishi Gautama. Now every day, the Maharishi Gautama gets up really early, gets up right when he hears the rooster crow in the morning, and he walks down to the stream, and he takes a long bath in the cold water, and he meditates for like a couple hours, I don't know. And so Indra's like, oh, yes, this is my chance. And so it gets complicated, because Indra talked to the moon, and he said, okay, moon, I need you to crow like a rooster an hour before the real dawn. Can you do that? And the moon says, sure. The moon decides it's gonna crow like a rooster an hour before dawn, because that shit really makes sense. Let's just follow me here. So an hour before dawn, the moon crows like a rooster. Maharishi Gautama wakes up and goes, oh, time for my cold bath and my 2 hours of praying. Off we go. And off he goes. He doesn't seem to notice that it's really too early. He's off. And then Indra comes through the door. But he has used his magic to look like Maharishi Gautama, and he approaches the beautiful Ahalya, and he says, let's do it, baby! And she kind of looks at him and says, you know, you look like my husband, but you don't sound like my husband. And she has her magical powers of something, and she can discern that this is not her husband. Surprise, surprise, it's Indra. But she's so flattered. This is the story talking. This ain't me. I didn't make this shit up. So she's so flattered that Indra, the leader of the gods, has decided to come all this way and make the moon sound like a rooster and look like her husband. He's done all of this shit just to get a piece of ass. She's impressed by that shit. It actually works. Gentlemen, don't take too much note. This is a myth. This is not real. Do not take this as your playlist. But in this story, that shit actually worked.
and she actually has sex with this guy. She knows who he is. She knows it's not her husband. Yada yada. She has sex with him. I don't get. So, okay, so they did it. Fine. And right at the moment they're finishing up, and Indra is doing that, well, it's been nice, and she's like, call me. And right at that moment, Maharishi Gautama comes running back from his bath, like, something's fishy, something's off here. And he catches the two of them. Oh, busted. Oh, now he's like the sage and the rishi, and he meditates, but he's ripped. He's really mad, and I think he kind of loses his cool. And he starts dealing out curses, like bad, scary, like who the fuck thinks of this? Like, he really dealt it. So first of all, he curses the moon, because you know the moon did the whole, the moon tried to pretend to be a rooster and did all this shit. So apparently, the reason why the moon looks spotted is because Maharishi Gautama cursed the moon for helping this sin happen. So, eek. Okay, so that's not a good start. Then he turns to his wife and he curses her. He says, you cheated on me out of vanity. You were flattered by this asshole. I shall remove your beauty, which is the source of your vanity. He turns her into a rock and leaves her by the side of the door, and he says, you're gonna stay a rock, and no one will look at you, and no one will think you're beautiful until one of the gods comes and forgives you. Shit. So he's not done. So Indra, meanwhile, is like, I'm just gonna leave now. And he's like, not so fast, motherfucker! Indra's like, and I'm like, wouldn't this be the time for the sky god to be like, pah, 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 thunder and lightning, and instead Indra's like, oh my god. He's like scared as shit. And he should be, because those other two curses were nothing compared to what Maharishi Gautama came up with. I don't know who thinks up this shit. So he turns to Indra and he says, okay, pussy hound, you like the pussy so much, right? So first off, I'm gonna take away what you need to enjoy that pussy that you love so much. Dick is gone, like that. Gone. Okay, so that's bad. And Indra's thinking, okay, this is really bad. There's a part two to this curse. It's a twofold. It's a twofer, right? A twofer? Can we say that a curse? A twofer. All right, so no dick. Great. Now, okay, pussy hound. I don't speak Urdu, but I'm sort of liberally translating what I imagine that the Hindu sage said. And he said to the god, pussy hound, I am now going to make sure that anytime anyone ever looks at you, they will see nothing but that which you desire above all else. And he covered Indra's body with not one, not 20, not 500, but 1,000 pussies. Yes, the leader of all of the gods, the ruler of the universe, is covered with 1,000 vulvae. Vulvae? Vulva? I texted my husband one time about our car, and he was like, what? I was trying to tell him that our Volvo needed gas, but somehow he thought it was a booty call. So anyway, so I don't know. The long and short of it is I don't know the plural for vulva. I'm going to go with vulvae, vulvas. Okay, 1,000. Picture it. Use your imagination, children. 1,000 pussies all over. Can you fit 1,000 pussies all over the square inch box? Like every bit of a... Okay. So now you have the leader of the gods, the leader of the universe, the one who's supposed to make everything go and do the weather. He's hiding in a corner in the dark, and everyone's like, gosh, Indra's not social anymore. Have you seen Indra? No, he wasn't. I haven't seen him in the longest time. Where is Indra? Anybody seen Indra? No, he's like hiding out somewhere. How come? Pretty soon the story gets out. The leader of the gods, the master of the universe, is hiding over in the corner, won't do his job, won't do anything, because he's covered with 1,000 pussies. Oh, and he lost his dick. Okay, so like, I mean, usually you don't think, you know, you think, oh my god, losing his dick, that's like the worst thing that could happen. I don't know. I'm thinking that the 1,000 vulvas, vulvae, maybe that's worse, especially because once a month. Yes. I'm not making this shit up. I Googled it. It's true. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay, so after a while, a delegation of the gods goes to Brahma, the creator, and they're like, look, this is a problem. Okay, because, you know, we've got this guy over in the corner. He's supposed to be running the universe and the weather, but he can't do shit. You know, it's too bad he lost his dick, but come on, the pussies and the, you know, once a month, I mean, it's just, it ain't pretty. We got to do something about this. So, you know, Brahma gives him penance, and eventually what happens is, after penance and repentance and everything, the 1,000 pussies are turned into eyes. Ah, see, you know, of course, you know that I'm Googling all of this. So, like, as soon as I read about, ooh, God covered with 1,000 pussies, I'm like, image, image, image. I'm like trying to find pictures or it didn't happen. So if you look up Indra, you're going to find him and he's covered with eyes all over. Okay, so sure. Okay, so he ended up with eyes all over. And he, believe me, he was very relieved. But now you know how he ended up with 1,000 eyes all over his body. Let this be a lesson to you. Don't make the Maharishi Gautama angry, because believe me, there are worse things than losing your penis. So that's the end of that myth.
There's a couple who live in the city and want to go back to the land. So they buy a farm way out in the country. And it turns out to be a pig farm. About pigs, they know absolutely nothing, but they have a pig farm. And after a while, they realize that they have big adult pigs, but they have no little cute baby pigs, which is how, when they talk themselves into this, that, oh, baby pigs are so cute, and they make good pets, and blah, 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 we don't have to eat them, maybe we could sell them, and people could have them as pets. But they have no cute baby pigs. So they're forced to go to their neighbor and ask him. And he explains, you have a pig farm, and your pigs are all sows, which are female pigs. You do not have any male pigs. You have to take your sows to a boar and have them be service, is the technical term. And so early one morning, after finding out where there is someone who has a boar and making arrangements, they line the pigs up and put a ramp up to the back of the truck and get the pigs into the truck and put up the gate of the truck and drive off to this other farm where their pigs are introduced to a boar. And then they get them back in the truck and they drive home and they let the pigs out. And time goes by and there's still no little cute little baby pigs. There's nothing happening. So they talk to the neighbor and the neighbor says, well, maybe it didn't take. You use so-and-so's boar. Well, he's getting old. Maybe try this other guy's boar. He's younger and he's got a better reputation. So they round up the pigs and put them in the truck and take them off to the other farm and introduce them to the other boar. And again, nothing happens. And so they do this a couple times. And they ask the neighbor, you know, how will we know it works? How will we know if it really worked? And the neighbor says, well, if it works, instead of moping around in the pen, they'll be out in the field eating grass. So after the last time that they take their pigs to the boar and bring them back, early in the morning, the wife says to the husband, go check on the pigs and see what they're up to. And he goes out and he comes back and she asks him, are they out in the field eating grass? And he says, no, they're in the truck. And one of them's honking the horn.